So we're now recording for the Hanged Man, so long as weather permits. Yeah, but of course, remember the bee comes up in the Empress card. It's associated with the Empress, with fertility and everything. I was also reading or listening to a book that talks about bees being associated with Artemis and thereby also Mary Magdalene. And that bees are almost universally, honey is actually almost universally associated with, is used in the ancient world, was used in the ancient world as like a substance for communion, and would always be associated with goddesses. And in the very early Christian communion, they would do bread and wine, but they would also do milk and honey along with the bread and wine. This is like pre-Pauline Christianity, or the Christianities that competed with Pauline Christianity. Of course, we know Pauline Christianity won out because that's the one that the Roman government liked. But
human created things, right? Bread and wine came from human hands. Milk and honey don't.
Right.
I mean, certainly elements in bread and wine do, obviously, right?
Yeah.
But the craft of bread and the craft of wine.
But it was interesting that honey almost universally was associated with goddess worship. Because honey is also sacred to Isis.
Really?
Yeah. But honey in the Western tradition, or bees in the Western tradition, are associated with Western Christian tradition, are associated with Mary Magdalene.
Where are you getting, like, how do you know that? How have I?
I listen to really obscure theological books as I'm commenting on students. I'll look up the title of the book I got that from. I didn't just take me a second. Mm-hmm.
Denise, do you remember me? Can you hear me?
I hear you.
Okay, do you remember me last Tuesday when we were doing readings? Not yesterday, but last Tuesday when I got back from Austin, we were doing tarot readings, me and you only. Mm-hmm. Kurt jumped on later. Do you remember me pulling out my brand new Crow Oracle and showing it to you guys?
Yes.
It's gone.
Okay.
And I tore my already disheveled house up even more looking for it.
Well, you're going to find it because Mercury is going into retrograde soon, and that's when you actually find stuff that you've been looking for. You don't want to start anything new, but it's Mercury.
Well, I thought Mercury was going into retrograde today. No?
No. Next. Oh, wow. What card is that?
So this is the Spirit of the Animals. It's an oracle.
Oh, that is cool.
But it is...
Yeah.
And it represents, it also talks about community. You are a powerful creator. Your work blesses everything you touch. Be open to receiving sweetness. You are the queen of abundance.
Okay, CJ, so listen to that.
Send me a picture of that card later.
You saw a bee today, so that's your message.
Thank you. Thank you.
Queen of Abundance. So the Hanged Man. I really enjoyed Rachel Pollack's take on the Hanged Man because it's so positive.
Exactly. And you know what? I've always heard that it's stale and stagnant and you can't do anything, when actually after reading her, I found that it's in that place that you're doing everything from. Yes.
Right. And you know, Go ahead, Denise.
Well, it's a hard place to be for people who are people who are constantly moving.
Mm-hmm.
They're constantly moving. They can't sit still long enough. Right. There's a like an artificial need to be busy. And I think this is where maybe for some folks, their relationship to the hangman is going to evoke that negativity. Right. It's like, I want to keep moving, but I can't. Right. And so the lesson and why it is that you need to stay still doesn't mean that nothing is moving. There's movement. It's just that it's a different sort of movement, right? And so that's really, I think, a beautiful lesson. And how to bring that forward. Okay. I'm trying to get this picture for you guys. Yeah, I think that she has this really lovely take. On there it is, CJ just sent it to you. Do you want me to send it to you too, Kurt?
Sure.
I'll just put it in the.
You should post it in the group because I feel like this is not, I feel like oracles are still a part of what we're doing.
Mm-hmm. Post it in the group then.
Thank you for that. Oh, that is so pretty.
This whole deck is really beautiful.
Okay, this resonates with me way more than this. I think I'm going to let this blessed be deck go. The more I think of it, then it's just, I get away from you and it just doesn't resonate, but this resonates.
Yes. Well, and I bought the Spirit of the Animals Oracle because it's oh my God. I know we're off topic right now, but I mean.
Oh, that's cool.
My God, and it's gorgeous.
That is, yeah.
The artwork is just absolutely beautiful. Yeah.
Do they have it on Amazon?
I'm sure they do.
I got it. Yeah, that's where I ordered it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've been incorporating oracles into my readings.
Yes, I like them. Oh, my God.
For about a year. I mean, just, woo, this one just flew out of my hand. This one wanted to be seen.
Oh, nice. What is that? That's a panther, but what is he doing?
Well, a jaguar.
Jaguar.
Old soul.
That's right. My campus, the jaguars, yeah.
Isn't that gorgeous? Well, that's literally, this card kind of flew out of my hand, so it wanted to be seen. So I imagine we are a gathering of old souls to some degree, right? And then butterfly. I mean, they're just beautiful. So if you're going to look at an oracle deck and you're drawn to an animal deck.
Well, and I like the artwork, like as a inspiration for other artwork.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
I'll be back. I'm going to go take that plant down that's in that tall stand.
Yeah. No, it's getting, and then here's the cut, the back of the card.
Oh, that's cool.
Which is really beautiful as well. But I was going to say that I ended up buying this deck because I saw it in a reading with the spirit song tarot,
mm-hmm.
which of course is the animal tarot. And I was like, they're just beautiful. So I bought it. And then it comes with this book.
I'm looking it up on Amazon now. Let's see.
Yeah, it comes with the spirit. I mean, this is a nice, has a gorgeous picture of the card, and then you get all of the commentary with it. Just a beautiful deck. Just gorgeous.
Yep, it comes right up. Oh, that is inexpensive.
Yes, it's like less than 20, 25.
It's $18.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Well, no, there's actually two. There's Spirit of the Animals Oracle and then Spirit of the Animals Oracle Card Deck and Guidebook.
Okay, so it's got the, let me see.
Is it the Collette Baron Reed or is it the other one?
No, it is the, by Jody.
Okay, yeah, no. Hers is
Jody listed. Who?
Bergsma, B-E-R-G-S-M-A. I'll put it in the chat.
Yeah, hers is less than 20. Yep, I just bought it with tax for less than 20.
Yeah, I'm just, and then if you were to pair it, if you had this,
the spirit song
tarot,
which is in our gallery, actually.
It's a beautiful, and okay, yeah. I bought that one too.
I love that one. Day. Yeah,
it was a day where I was like, oh, yeah. And I couldn't overcome my impulses, and I bought both of them. So I guess I should go get that deck too.
What's that deck called?
The Spirit Song. And I'm actually interested in y'all's take on the Hangman from that deck because of the animal they use is interesting.
Oh, that deck, yeah.
Yeah.
It's beautiful, but it's not one that calls to me that I need it yet. Yeah. Not yet.
Have you seen, Denise, have you seen the Hangman from Spirit Song?
I haven't.
It's a praying mantis. So it's kind of it's an interesting choice. I think it's a praying mantis, unless it's another insect.
Let me see. Let me pull it. Let me double check.
Yeah.
I got the thing.
There is.
Yeah, it's a praying mantis.
Okay, it is.
But it's a praying mantis. Yeah, I mean, because we'll get the thing about the cards themselves, they are a very light pastel, like the colors mm-hmm. are very, very light. So when we see them in your gallery, the color saturation seems like it's more deep. It's really not. You have to really be in a well-lit room if you want to see the colors. The colors are very soft. But in Praying Mantis here, the Hanged Man, it says patience and perspective. And so the idea, I suppose, that the praying mantis, I've seen praying mantises in the most interesting angles on the sides of building on the third floor of our building that my office is in. I'll be going, you know, in the stairwell, it's all glass windows. And then I go down the stairs and there's the praying mantis hanging there on the window of the third floor of the building. And I was like, that's so interesting. You know, it's just so interesting that as I walk by, there's that praying mantis doing that kind of thing. So I, you know, this idea of perspective and patience, I don't know a whole lot about the praying mantis per se.
I know is that she bites her husband's head off.
Yeah, she kind of, you know, after they do that kind of thing.
But, you know, if we're looking at the initiatory aspect of the Hangman, then that's appropriate. Both of those characteristics of the praying mantis would be appropriate.
Well, let me see what it says here. You want to take a look?
Yeah, sure.
I know you're gonna. I don't want to.
No, no. I mean, there's 7 pages of gallery.
Oh, okay.
So
let's go ahead and I will need readers for this. Patience and perspective. A prophet of calm and patience, praying mantis changes his landscape by hanging upside down, reveling in a moment of observance and clarity while he waits. This is a time of suspension between the physical and spiritual worlds. He is your guide to opening yourself to new perspectives through which you will discover solutions and gain new insight. When life is at a standstill, look to the past for lessons learned, yet look to the future through the eyes of spirit renewed. A shift in the perspective develops foresight, which will bring a sense of peace and understanding in where you want to go. In the stillness of meditation, You're accessing greater depth of wisdom and creativity. So the keywords are perspective, patience, enlightenment, sacrifice, prophecy, letting go. And I guess prophecy in the sense that is tied to that sense of enlightenment or that
prophecy. Knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Prophecy, letting go. I think one of the things that's really interesting, and I'll note it here, although I haven't been so up close to a praying mantis that I can confirm this, but it looks pretty serene, right? And I think that's the theme that Rachel Pollack brings up, right? This note, and you know, that it's not a negative, like that she shocks people read it as a negative thing. And it's, you know, that is if you're willing to kind of release into and let go and be part of the actual moment that the hangman is representing, the concept that the hangman is representing. But more than anything, I think this notion of serenity within that, right? That it's almost like a very interesting, you know, I think, and this is, I'm going to speak from personal perspective here or personal experience. There have been times at different points in my life, my adult life, where I have been intentionally busy to the point of burnout. Mm-hmm. Right. Then I've been intentionally busy to the point to avoid. Right.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
I mean, just total and complete avoidance, avoiding how I'm feeling, avoiding that I have to do the dishes, whatever, avoiding that I have to do my taxes, whatever the case may be. Right. Whatever is kind of causing that avoidance. But then when you force me to stop and be silent and be quiet, and I say you force me, a circumstance arises where if I've gone on a social binge, for example, right? So before the pandemic, I was always, I had a different coffee date every day. I had a different friend, you know, date every day. I was meeting the so-and-so for dinner, blah, 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 blah. And then all of a sudden, everybody was busy. And I couldn't create, I couldn't schedule any more, you know, social days. And I was forced to be quiet and to be sort of like to sit there. Of course, you can find other things to fidget around with, right? But, you know, you can always do that. But that sort of, the point I'm trying to make here is that resistance to it. And then when you finally sort of melt into it for a little while and you realize, okay, well, this may be where I'm going to be at. It can be really painful when you're resisting that. So I can see where the negative response to it is that sort of resistance. Because resistance doesn't feel good necessarily, right? You're sort of resisting this. There's another phrase that I've come across and I use it. I created a set of sort of messages that sometimes I will use in my readings as well. I just sort of hand wrote these out. And one of them is let go or be dragged. And I think that's what happens in a hangman thing, a hangman situation where when nothing is coming into, I mean, when nothing is aligning to continue with that forward momentum that you had beforehand, and it's sort of like, you know, everything is sort of flat. Nobody's available. There's nothing to do. We're in a pandemic or whatever. I think the pandemic has potentially been a hangman. We've talked about it, right? Different aspects.
Yeah.
Of the pandemic.
It's
a collective hangman moment, right?
Yeah. It's asked us to, and it is very much that moment where we can kind of embrace it. You know, a lot of people embraced it and you know, and then many others, you know, did not. And even saying that, though, is speaking from a place of privilege, because, like, you know, some of my students, you know, like they were, they lost their whole family income, you know, or virtually all their family income. Mm-hmm. Some of them, even to this day, I have students whose whole families have COVID.
Right.
You know, and
they lost three or four members of their family to COVID.
Right. And so that's something to be to and so in that regard, you know, the hangman viewing the hangman's awareness of the intensity of sacrifice, you know, is also important too. I mean, if we're going to talk about this being a hangman moment, it had the hangman moment has so many different layers, so to speak. You know, as we get into talking about the sort of the traditional esoteric discussion of the hangman, which is as the as representative of the sacrificial king, you know, Jesus, Osiris, Odin, so on.
Odin, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, you know, so I think it's just important to mention that, mm-hmm. you know, we can look, oh, you know, yeah, I got to read a lot of books during the pandemic. I got to do some mantra chanting and some yoga and some this and some that and so on and so forth. And I didn't have to take the bus and I got to do all my work from home and, you know, so on and so on. Yeah. But, you know, a lot of people really, really, really suffered, you know, I mean, that and that's something that I personally, I'm not speaking for everyone, but I personally, I have to force myself to keep that in perspective, you know?
Yeah.
So I have to tell you, I'm on the other side of that coin because I have a year's worth of mortgage payments waiting for me to start paying right. today. A year's worth of utility bills, both water and electric, and no income.
And you had a loved one, a very dear loved one, have COVID.
Very sick.
You know, yeah.
Well, yeah. And during this time, my biological father that I never got to meet as a grown up, like just when I was a baby that I can't really remember, passed away. And that was happened all during COVID. Like it's been rough. Like I have to say, I'm on the side of your students right now, Kurt.
A lot of sacrifice.
Lot of. But at the same time, it's been like one of the best times of my life. Honestly. And I know that sounds crazy and weird.
Not really.
I think that's what the hangman is. It's exactly that. It's that. It's that.
Like I want, like I needed this, whether it comes with that sacrifice or not. When else was this going to happen in my life? Like we're already like reaching the halfway mark of life. And like, when else was it going to happen? It wasn't. If it didn't happen now, it wasn't going to happen.
Yeah. And if you look at the next card is death. And death, of course, is rebirth. Death and rebirth are essentially synonymous. So,
well, it's talking about, so Rachel Pollack on page 153 of Tarot Wisdom is talking about, she first approaches it on 152, but she talks about that initiation mm-hmm. and it being a dying to be reborn.
Right.
Which I guess pushes us into death.
And, you know, my hopefully, it's kind of presumptuous to call her my friend, but someone that I know, Pastor Arlene Infante Turner spoke last weekend about laying down one's life, you know, to essentially laying down one's life to be reborn, you know, and then that essentially being the gospel theme, whether you look at it as something that happens to Jesus individually or that can happen to all of us collectively. You know,
I think both and yes,
exactly,
and.
Exactly. Right. But this idea that we lay down our burdens, you know, and I like how Pollack puts it too, you know, when we look at the justice card we kind of see what we have, right? We see what we're holding, you know, and once we get after the justice, then we have the hangman who is like, okay, now that we know what we've got, you know, now here's how we're going to deal with, you know, here's how we're going to, we're essentially going to lay that down, let that all fall, we're going to turn ourselves upside down, let that all fall out of our pockets or whatever, let that all, you know, let that all go, And then what's left is that which is eternal, that which is, and so on and so forth. And then thereby, it's the rebirth from there. Also, this is very much, I think it's Pollock who talks about how the eye sees everything in reverse, how light is actually brought into the.
We flip it upside down.
That's also from the Bhagavad Gita. Yeah, that's also from the Bhagavad Gita. The idea that if you want to perceive the world as it actually is, you look at a tree. You look at a tree in a reflection on a lake, because right. The true nature of reality is that one's roots are in the heavens or in the spirit. One's roots are in the spirit, and then from the spirit, we grow into this reality.
And she talks about that in the book.
Yeah.
Too.
And so that's the image of the hangman. I mean, his feet are up in the air.
And with the top of the tree, which are the roots. So his roots are the same as the tree roots, which really spoke to me on the spiritual level when I read that. It really spoke to me coming from a place of, oh, great spirit, Mother Earth, yada, 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 because as above, so below, that just really rang true with this particular card. And it kind of brought in that whole, my attraction to being open to that type of spirituality. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And the idea, and I believe, and I read this in several sources, the idea that it's important that the hangman is actually hanging on a tree, because the tree is alive, like you're saying. Mm-hmm. You know, the tree is alive.
Well, and that's the tree of life.
Yeah.
In essence, yes?
Right. And in fact, a more Kabbalistic source that I was looking at says that the hangman card can actually be seen as exemplifying the entire tree. I don't have the diagram, but yeah, you can.
No, but it did it in Rachel Pollack's book too. So when you turn, when you flip him and you stick him next to the tree of life drawing or the diagram, everything matches, and she explained everything, which gets a little of much, but that, and then also there was something else that went with that. What else goes with that? So that's on page 150, just so that everyone who goes back to watch.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Oh, and then that's where she talked about the world. If you put him next to the world card,
he's the world dancer upside down. So what she was talking about with that is that there are actually three cards at the center of the major arcana, that it represents a process. So it's the hermit, justice, and those cards all together.
The hermit, justice, and what? I remember reading that.
The hangman. It's those last three cards we've done. So it was like, it was the hang, and the last week we did justice, right?
Yeah.
And then before that we did, was it the hermit? Or wheel of fortune. So it was the wheel, sorry. It was the wheel, justice, and the hangman. And she said that those three are actually at the center, that becoming to that center space is a process, and it's a process that takes place through those three cards. And if you think about the images on those cards, it kind of makes sense, because the wheel turns, right? The wheel, you know, and something is coming into being. Then we get to the justice, and the justice is all about assessment to the assessment of the heart and so forth. And then once we get to that, then we get to the initiation, which then leads to the rebirth.
And you said wheel was something starting to come into being,
right? Because if you remember the way that card is described, it's got the different figures on the wheel, and you've got like the Sphinx figure, and the Sphinx figure is kind of turning into prominence on the wheel.
Maybe I missed. Maybe that was when I wasn't there last week or something. because I never went back and watched the beginning of whatever it was. I think that was the week I missed.
That may have been the wheel, yeah.
Okay, and so she says those three cards are at the middle?
At the center of the major arcana, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's because of what?
Well, it's because of their placement, but also that those three, there's not, she said there's not a single card at the center, but those three, because those three represent a process of coming into being.
I think I didn't understand all of that in the book. I think I read that, but I didn't understand it. But now that you've explained it, I understand it.
And what's really cool, and I mean, I know you'll remember reading this, is that she talked about, I really liked how she talked about 12 being 6 doubled. And so yeah. it's the high priest, it's the high priestess essentially elevating the lovers from the physical reality to spiritual reality.
Okay, say that one more time, please.
So it's 2 is the high priestess and 6 is the lovers. Right. So it's the high priestess doubling. It's the high priestess essentially doubling the lovers into a spiritual reality. So basically what the hangman represents, one way of looking at the hangman is the lover's card in the realm of the high priestess. Because you know how the high priestess is also in that meditative realm, you know. So the hangman is similar, but the hangman is the energy of the lovers in that realm. And if you think about that, that makes sense, because if one is going to make a sacrifice, right, why is it that, what's the most noble reason to sacrifice something?
For love.
Is love. Right, exactly. So...
I know this has nothing to do with Tarot and we're recording, but I'm worried about my cat, Jasper. He didn't come home.
Oh, dear.
So y'all can keep going. I haven't turned up as loud as I can get.
Okay. And so CJ went to go try to find Jasper. He's missing.
Oh, no.
Well, he's not missing. He just hasn't come home yet.
Oh, but you don't understand how bad the storm is here right now. We had a little bit of hail. We had a little bit of hail and it's like poor. Like I wouldn't want to go outside right now. I'm even worried about the plants I didn't bring in.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
I like put them on Denise. I put the plants that weren't potted yet and the potted plant that was in the tall thing on the Corona table under the tree, but that's the best I was able to do.
Yeah.
And the cat's missing.
Raining. It's raining. I was like, gentle rain.
Oh, it's not it's gentle.
Pouring rain. I was like, the hope for gentle rain.
There was lightning earlier here.
Yeah, there's been lightning. It's been because you're on the south side of town.
Zarzamora. Yeah, like around Zarzamora.
No, okay. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, yeah. So Kurt, when you were talking about the High Priestess card number 2 doubling, I guess we multiply her times the lovers, but how do we know? Are we just like
I started reading that, but that was
where I got lost and I told you it was getting too deep. I had to close the book.
That was Pollock's thing, because you know Pollock likes to play with the numbers.
I know, but how did she pick those two cards, the High Priestess and the Lovers?
Because she just saw a relationship with that card, just like,
and it's from sacrifice for love.
Sacrifice for love, yeah.
Because that's the most noble reason to sacrifice.
I came up with that. I said that, but that's, you know,
that's a Kurtism.
That's my Gospel of John. That's the Gospel of John coming in.
For God to love the world.
Yeah. Because the hangman is the crucifixion. I mean that's what it represents.
It is.
And interestingly, you know, Pollock also points out, every source I looked at points out that to be hung upside down by the foot like that was considered ultimate humiliation, and that that's how they hung Mussolini.
They
apparently in the Italian tarot, which
tarot Marseille,
if you go back to those decks, it's not the hanged man, it's called the traitor.
The traitor,
and that is or Judas.
We talked about that because money was falling out of his pockets and whatnot.
The 30 pieces of silver. And so that hanging Mussolini and his wife by their feet that way was
And the Apostle Peter supposedly was crucified upside down, and whether or not that's historical, you know, that
right.
that you know that image is.
What do you want? What do you want more of?
Okay, you said Mussolini and his wife Denise by what, and then you said by something, and then I couldn't hear two of y'all. By their feet.
By their feet.
Okay, got it.
And they were talking about.
Oh, sorry. It's on page 149.
Yeah, no, I read it. I'm just getting what they're saying out, because when I read stuff, sometimes I don't understand it as much as when I hear it spoken in different words.
Yeah.
Me too. That's why I listen to the book also, you know. Yeah. I mean,
I have it's one of those things where, I mean, it's just, I mean, I that's just the learning process, right? I mean, every time I read a text a second or third or fourth time, I'm like, what? Where did that come from? It was always there, right? It just made the connection.
Well, and what I thought was interesting on page 149, because now, Angel, you got me back on page 149. I highlighted that very first sentence that says, understand this in terms of social conformity. The person refuses to vote, to devote himself. And that's kind of how I feel, because like I've tried to devote myself to careers. And I can't even do it in real estate where I can do my own thing. I can't even do it there. Like I would just rather go be happy and free. You know what I mean? Like I don't know why my spirit cannot do it. And so that is the part that stuck out to me that I resonate with.
Are you sure you're not an Aquarius? Like, I'm just playing with you. But.
But when we find out, I must have Aquarius in there somewhere, or yeah. I wouldn't. Yeah.
Yeah.
Very Sagittarian as well.
Yeah.
So especially the focus on philosophy and
maybe that's why Richard likes you, Denise.
Oh right, that could be.
Seriously.
Well, maybe. That's why, Denise, that's why you have coffee dates with every day of the week. That's a Sagittarius thing.
I know. That's like
that's a Sagittarius. Yeah.
Well, see, and I can do that if people wanted to meet me every day.
You know, I think that to me, coffee is all about the social, right?
And yeah, of course.
Coffee itself, the aroma.
I love coffee. The coffee is amazing.
This is actually apropos to our discussion, because you know the history of coffee, right? I actually know this, right? Because you know I know things that other people don't care about, but the history of coffee, like it was actually banned in the Middle East. They started out the shepherds would just eat the beans to keep them awake so that they could watch their sheep at night. And they, eventually they figured out, okay, we can roast it and make, so the coffee shop sprung up and they got banned all throughout the Middle East, because it became very, very subversive, because people would like stay up all night and drink coffee and essentially talk against the government, talk against religious authorities, and do what people always do in coffee shops to this day, you know? And the thing is it came to the West, and for whatever Pope it was at the time, he liked it. And so he drank, he said, we're going to cheat Satan this drink by Christianizing it. We're going to cheat Satan this drink by Christianizing it.
We're going to cheat
Satan this drink by Christianizing it.
Cheat, C-H-E-A-T?
Yes. Yes. Because it was a Muslim, it came from the Middle East. It came
from... We're going to cheat Satan?
Yes. This drink, because it was considered satanic because it came from Muslims.
I don't know what that... My brain's not understanding. Cheat Satan this drink. There's a word missing in there.
In other words, Satan doesn't get to claim this drink. Yeah. We're going to make it Christian.
Satan, it's like, you know, jokes on you, Satan. We're going to make this a Christian drink.
And it is also, coffee is also, speaking of subversiveness and rebellion, it was the drink of the American Revolution, because George Washington popularized the drinking of coffee, because as opposed to tea, right? Because tea was British,
associated with the British, with the crown.
So the coffee is very much a hangman-esque. See, here we go. Need to start hangman coffee.
And you said that when it came to the West, where the Pope said we're going to cheat Satan this drink by doing what?
By Christianizing it. In other words, the Pope liked it, so it was okay.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
There was the, what do I want to say? No, I guess really, I'd like to, I mean, I think we've already talked a little bit about our personal relationships to the Hanged Man. And why I've had these moments, when I'm in the resistance still, the Hanged Man just feels like, you know, so I guess it's the work on your patience kind of thing.
Very personal relationship with it, because of the nature of my body. My body literally cannot move in certain ways, and so in a sense, you know, I'm stuck like that. And you know, and I can, one of the most comfortable positions for me to sit in is the half lotus, and that's a yoga position. And so I'm always like, you know, and so on the one hand, I'm thinking, well, you know, I have this body that's basically ideal for yoga and contemplation and all that stuff. But on the other hand, you know, I don't want to do that. You know, I'm very resistant to that kind of stuff as well, even though, you know, that would seem to be the position that for whatever karmic reasons and so forth, that's the body that I have. And that's what I'm potentially physically suited to do. And so, yeah, it's that whole thing that you're talking about, you know. And we're not a Western culture, particularly American culture, is not other than the Quakers, it's not a contemplative culture, you know.
So I just happen to be in the contemplative group here.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I've seen people go to a Zen sitting, for example, and just literally freak out because she
It is, yeah. If you think that Zen meditation is like Headspace the app, you're going to be really surprised. Yeah. So if there were comfort, I'm using the number six on Pollock's reading. What's the comfort in the Hanged Man?
I mean, the idea of initiation is comforting, you know, because it represents, not only new beginning, but new connections as well. Or uncovered connections.
But this can't last forever.
Right.
There's going to be a movement that I recognize that's a physical movement along with the spiritual movement.
Kurt, can you say what you said? Initiation what?
Initiation is not only new beginnings, but also new or uncovered connections.
It's raining out there, buddy. It's raining, puppy.
Oh.
Oh.
Yeah, Nut-Nut doesn't even care. She's just on her bed like she normally is. She doesn't even...
And then, so Denise, I guess you were talking that there's that part where, but there's, it can't last forever. Right. There's going to have to be movement.
There will be, I mean, there's always movement, I think.
Well, that's where we are, though. That's right. Kind of, we're on the cusp of that movement starting to happen.
Mm-hmm. Right. And so,
collectively.
Yeah. And so there's this, yeah, that the comfort is that it's a temporary place usually.
Oh, I get what you're saying. I get it.
But there will be a kind of movement that we recognize. It may not be exactly the same.
Temporary. That makes sense to me. That makes sense.
There's a temporariness. I mean, it requires the patience, but it's temporary. But I think it's also one of those things too, where if you do not allow yourself to melt into the circumstance and to recognize the spiritual growth, the spiritual awareness, that you will extend your stay.
Right.
And then you on.
Yeah.
Wait, I'm trying to absorb what you're saying. What? Say that one more time.
So in other words,
I want to hear what you said first.
If you don't melt into the situation, the hanged man circumstance, then I think and recognize that there is spiritual, there's a movement, all of that's going on, there's potential there. Then I think you extend your stay. And what because that's I think that's maybe a form of resistance.
Right?
Yes. The form of resistance, right? The resistance is going to keep you in that place. And that's
why we repeat lives. You know, that's why we have multiple lives, you know, because we keep trying to learn the same lesson. We essentially get stuck.
We learn the same lesson over and over again, yes?
Yeah.
Within the one life. I mean, even within, there's a repetition.
Right, exactly.
And even over lifetimes.
Yeah. That's why the same people get reincarnated together over and over and over again. That's actually not
But both of us can't be having to learn the same lesson together over and over.
Yes, you can. Depends on what you do to each other over and over and over again.
Okay, well, I'm trying to wrap my head around that one, you guys.
Mm. Hey, Kurt, let's look at your gallery. Does anybody else have anything?
No.
I'd love to look at what you guys, I went and I picked a whole bunch too, but I think there may be some repeats.
Yeah, there probably are some repeats. A couple of these, let me see if I can pull it up here. Here we go.
What you doing, little bug? What you doing, sweet pea? So cute.
So here's the Llewellyn Classic, and this, you can see here, this is the idea of the yogi pulling the energy from the root chakra to the head, and and of course he's tied to the tree. He's got his legs in the figure four of the emperor. Now this dude's got a big, I just now noticed that. This dude's got a pretty big erection.
In all of those, that's the, which deck
Robin,
is that?
Robin Wood.
The Robin Wood deck. They all do. Their package is huge.
Well, that's probably Robin Wood. Yeah, I mean, yeah, yeah.
She, that's sort of like, okay.
I never noticed that. And I used to have this deck as a teenager, and you'd think as a teenage young kid, I would have noticed something like that, but.
It may have gotten bigger over the reprinting.
Yeah.
More pronounced.
But there is a, in the esoteric interpretation of the Hangman, one of the interpretations is unsatisfied sexual desire and or sexual desire.
Really. Who says that? Oh, in the esoteric version?
That's from Tarot Deciphered by Inman Moline.
And it's unsatisfied sexual desire?
Yeah. Yeah, or that which is satisfied by masturbation versus, you know, in the company of a partner. I just included this one because I thought it was just really pretty. I like the this Mucha. Version. Yeah,
it's from
Tarot Mucha. Yeah, which I know nothing about that deck, but. But I just thought.
I think what's interesting about that one is that his head is turned.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You're right. His head
and
is.
And there's grapes in that one. And I don't know the symbology of grapes, but I know it has to do with abundance. And so
there's a couple of things. One of the figures. Well, Attis, I believe, Attis is one of the sacrificial kings that's related to that's conflated with Jesus and Osiris and so forth. And I believe he dies on a he's sacrificed on a vine, I believe. And also the idea of those kings being related to Dionysus, and also Jesus himself, I am the fruit of the vine, right? So that's where the grapes would come in, I would think.
Mm,
and it's interesting too that the leaves here are, these are autumn leaves.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
They're changing.
Oh, I like that symbology.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then if you look, I don't know if this Tarot Mucha does it on all their cards. But there's a little bitty, only a line drawing, it's not colored in, a leaf on the right-hand side above his elbow, and on the left-hand corner bottom, tiny, even tinier.
Mm-hmm.
Not colored in, just a line drawing.
That's interesting.
And I don't know, to know about letting go, releasing, that part of it.
Yeah. No, but I do like this deck. I don't like I said, I don't know.
Do we know anything about this deck? Is this deck usually in our gallery?
No. See, this one came from a.
It's a new one.
Oh, it's the app, the dog app.
It's from a sampler.
And yeah, the sampler app.
And I'll look in the sampler, just to see if there's any that catch my eye. And the Hangman were some of the coolest ones. Like this one is from there too, from the Enchanted Tarot, which has been around for a long time. But I liked it because. Of just all the colors.
Yeah, that's beautiful. That looks like a fiber artist did that.
Yeah, yeah. This is not this one here in the center. This is not a happy
Well, that looks like Jesus to me.
It's Prometheus.
Yeah. Okay.
And so remember Prometheus he is one of the two titans who basically created human beings on behest of Zeus, and he was like very pro human beings, so he gave them fire. He gave fire to humanity, which Zeus did not like, because Zeus, it was tantamount to giving humanity technology. It was basically giving humanity technology, and Zeus said Zeus ordered him not to do it. but he did it anyway because he wanted humans to have a fighting chance and ultimately have a chance to be, to realize their own divinity, basically. So as a punishment, he gets tied to this rock and this vulture comes and eats out his liver every day.
Zeus punished him?
Zeus is punishing him, yeah. But this is what we were talking about, you know, sacrificing out of love. You know, he loves humanity, and so he gives them, you know, fire, and he full well knowing that, you know, he's going to get this kind of punishment. So FYI, the tornado warning is over.
Yay.
That's why I'm getting
a little dicey there for a while.
Yeah.
Admittedly,
I did not read up on this, the card from the Druid Craft. I don't know who this figure is. This is one of the most detailed images of a penis I've seen in these decks yet.
So what's interesting about this one is this is the first one we've seen where it's like he's gagged almost with, but with like what, lettuce or leaves? Like that's not even leaves from the tree.
Probably holly leaves or something like this. It's a druidic deck, so it's probably like holly leaves. Interestingly, we've got, if we look over here, I just now noticed this. That's what I like about being able to blow these cards up, because you can see we've got a scythe and we've got the wheat over here.
And you've got lemon. It looks like, I know lemons, I don't know if those are lemons, but you've got something that looks like lemons in the tree. You've got like blackberries, you've got like.
And all those berries and all that, they all have a different, they have different druidic, specific druidic meanings, which I'm not.
And is that mistletoe growing in the tree?
Yes, I bet that's mistletoe. I would almost guarantee you that's mistletoe. And of course.
That's what it looks like.
In Nordic myth, which is related to druid myth but not exactly the same, Balder, who is also a sacrificial figure, he gets killed with a mistletoe. CJ, you remember American Gods, when you've read the book, right? Or no,
I'm trying to listen to it, but I keep falling asleep because I listen to it to make me go to sleep.
Oh, okay, then I'm not going to. Yeah. American Gods has one of, I will just say American Gods has one of the best hangman scenes in it of any contemporary literature that I'm aware of.
Okay.
And so here is.
Okay, there we're getting to my cards here. Now. Yep.
And this is just great.
Well, and this is a female instead of a male, correct?
This is a woman.
Yeah, that's what I thought. And then are those runic symbols?
They are, and I just noticed that. That's exactly what that is.
And they're in a circle, so we have the whole circle thing going, uh-huh. Like the wheel.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and
she's over water.
Mm-hmm. And usually the light that's a halo isn't exactly a halo. It's almost like you're literally in God's light while you're in this position, if you would just, and if you see that this woman is super relaxed and comfortable, and since she's securing herself with her hand on her foot, but her hand is actually, while she's in this position, almost playing, if you will, in the water with those ancient sacred symbols. Mm-hmm.
And not only that, but she's almost like, and I read this somewhere too, that the hangman can be seen as an inverted magician also. Mm-hmm. And she kind of looks like an inverted magician in this.
With her hand.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And this might freak you. This is going to be a little bit subversive here, but if you've ever seen somebody in shibari, in Japanese rope tying, Mm-hmm. When, you know, where they're tied up in the Japanese ropes and they're suspended and they can't move. The reason that people like that, from what I've heard from people who do it, is that it forces them to be in a serene state, because they're being suspended by those ropes, and if they move they just can't move. Yeah. And to them it's just so incredibly peaceful. You know, so that actually,
they don't have a choice but to be at peace.
Yeah, I'm wondering if there's surrender. A shibari. I'm wondering if there's a right. And that's that
surrender,
and that's what she's doing here. She is like,
and shibari. There's a tremendous amount of trust.
Yeah,
you have to, and I think that this is part of what you have here too. Trust the process or trust the situation, right?
And she is trusting that light. So she is submerging herself into the light, or even calling that light to her. You can even see it as her calling the light to her. And what I like about the Light Seer's deck is that in all these cards that we've seen from it so far, there's nobody that's really, none of these figures are restrained per se. There's always a sense of they're doing whatever activity it is of their own will.
Hi, sweet pea.
You know, like the chariot with the guy on the surfboard.
Yes, that's what I was thinking of.
And you know, and so she is doing this of her own will. She's not tied up, you know, she's not tied to a tree. She's not, you know.
There's no traitor energy here.
No, not at all.
Strung her up. This is a choice.
Mm-hmm.
Heard, I don't think that your read of that is too far off. I think that's a really cool way to think about it. Because quite literally, one who is being suspended from rope is being... They're hanged in that sense, right? I mean, I think that that's a really astute...
And I'm wondering if there's ever been a tarot card done with Shibari as the Hanging Man, because that just seems like a missed opportunity if it hasn't been done yet. Somebody needs to do that.
Like, say it again. Somebody needs to do what?
Shibari as a Hangman.
I'm sure it's been done. No,
I would think so.
Okay, and then we have the good tarot.
Yeah. And this is almost like a Icarus type of figure. Like he looks like he's might be falling, or he might be, he is suspended because he's tied.
Yeah, and you can see that he's tied to, he's not even, honestly, there's no tie. It's just he's resting. Like if you look, it's not actually tied around his feet.
Oh yeah, you're right. It's not.
He's almost resting in it again, just like the Light Seers, of his own free will.
Yeah, exactly. And he is surrendered to it. And if you were to look at this, if you were to flatten it out and look at it like on a table and look straight down at it, he would be in like a relaxation pose, almost. You know, like a yogic relaxation. So yeah.
He's beautiful. Now that card, honestly, that one card out of that deck reminds me, Denise, of that Oracle deck, the spirit animal you were showing. Like it has that vibe to me. He's beautiful.
Yeah.
And then we have what? Shadowscapes?
Shadowscapes. Yeah.
So to me, I go back to the good tarot. He, like, I know you said Icarus and all of that, but I keep getting a sense of a dragonfly.
I think, I can see that. It's not Icarus because he's not falling.
And the dragonfly is abundance. That's its symbology. And remember, we were talking about in the other one with the grapes and everything and abundance and being like, so I get like, we need to start seeing when we're in these situations, we need to start flipping the script and looking through abundant glasses.
Yeah. And I think the people, you know, going back to the pandemic, I think for the people that were able to see some degree of abundance, you know, they've been able to, you know, it's been better. It hasn't been ideal, but it's been
right.
It's been better.
Dragonflies in some cultures also represent dream world.
Oh, wow.
Dream world. I did not know that.
You're going to see that again here in a little bit. that shows up again.
Do we know what cultures, Denise?
Oh gosh, I'd have to go back, but I certainly know that in some Native American cultures, the dragonfly represents the dream world. And the thing that's really interesting is it's actually the illusion between dreams and reality. Mm-hmm. So it plays on that tension, which I think is what we're getting here in The Hanged Man, right? Because if you really want to see what's real, look at it. The eye takes it in upside down and then flips it for us, right? So what's real, the dream or what we think is real?
And, you know, it's important to know, and Pollock brings this out a lot, you know, that the Hangman is one of the few cards that is the attribution for it is elemental water. You know, it's so... the idea of dream or water or the quality of water is with the Hangman.
Because water symbolizes dreams?
Subconscious.
Mm-hmm. Okay, remind me to speak to that later at the end after we're done.
Okay. I love the purple background on the Shadowscape.
It's beautiful.
Yeah. Hey,
are you saying hello to everybody?
Oh, hi.
Oh, he says hi, everybody.
Hi. Hello.
Are you being real cute? He's being so cute. He's being so good. Normally, he's like, he's mostly an outdoor dog. He sleeps inside, but he likes to spend his days outside. Mm-hmm. He loves it. Like, I think I might get a little doghouse or something because he may want to sleep outside.
Oh, you just sleep in a doghouse.
Right on, he's mine. A little doghouse. Yeah, he says, hey. He's going to be 1 year old on May 3rd.
That's so good. Oh,
Kurt, we can have a double party.
Yeah, because Nut-Nut is going to, her adoption day is the 8th.
Yes, there you go. It's beautiful.
But I think Nut-Nut's actually a Pisces, but her adoption day is the 8th.
Okay.
Yeah. And see, the 9th is when we're going to get our vote on the new pastor. So see, that's all, you know, important.
So just so y'all know, the weather, when y'all said the thing was over, it calmed down and now it's getting worse than it was to begin with.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Well, see, I probably got it before you did. Is it moving that way?
It was already almost this bad at the beginning. We had hail over here, you guys.
Okay. I don't.
But now it's getting really bad again.
Okay. There's nothing over here right now.
It's thundering, but it sounds like the rain has slowed. But CJ, it was really intense. Angel, was it really intense where you were at too?
Yeah, at first. And then it started hailing and it slowed down. But now, like just like you, it's just thunder and rain.
Wow.
Where do you live, Angel?
By Ingram Mall.
Oh, okay. I passed you on the way home. Okay. And I am opening Shadowscapes, the big book, when you're ready.
That's awesome. Like, yeah. There's so much going on in this card.
So can we start on Shadowscapes?
Yeah.
In the foggy depths of the woods, he dips his fingers into the red clay. and with a careful hand, he trails the patterns across his skin, across chest and arms and face. The spirals of red draw his mind into that place of deep meditation where thought becomes actions and where the stillness speaks with the voices of gods, of the gods. When the silence in his soul is absolute, he rises to his feet. The spirits of the forest watch as he passes in mute witness and respect. They reach out tentatively to touch his hallowed flesh and fall into his footsteps with solemn dignity. The procession arrives at the great oak. The hangman makes his choice of self-sacrifice. He goes willingly to his fate, unhinges his grip on control. So releasing control, and endures for the sake of the rewards such knowing sacrifice may bring. Ivy creeps along his body, binding and entwining him physically to the tree until they are one. I lost my place. Until they are one. Ivy is the symbol of determination and the unbreakable strength and will of the human spirit. In an echo of his action of faith and sacrifice, the Fae fold back their wings and free fall from their perches in the tree, entrusting themselves to the wind. Letting go and surrendering to experience and emotional release, accepting what is and giving up control, suspending action, sacrifice, as Odin hung upon the world tree Yggdrasil in his quest for knowledge, thus to attain the greatest rewards, one must be willing to give up the self. The hangman also urges you to reverse your view of the world and see things in a new light. Sometimes a change in one's perception of the world is required, a subtle shifting of the state of mind. And then it goes on in the sketchbook notes to talk about Odin, to talk about random tree thoughts, to talk about ivy. Ivy is tenacious, clinging and binding as it grows, thus a symbol to the Druids of determination and strength. So I guess to be in this, to get through this well, we also have to have that strength from the strength card and determination. Random tree thoughts, and what of the tree, which is as much as part of the image as the hangman himself. Thoughts of Yggdrasil, a grand ash at whose roots is the well of Mimir, whose branches spread across the heavens to cover the world, and of the elder oak of Sherwood Forest, a grand giant that truly exists, and in the hollow of which it is said the outlaws hid to be sheltered from their enemies. And then the only other thing it still has here is thoughts on Odin. Do you want to hear those?
Sure.
In Norse mythology, it is said that Odin sacrificed himself. For 9 days and nights, he fasted as he hung upside down from the branches of the great world tree, Yggdrasil. At the end of this time, he fell from the tree, having been enlightened by the secrets of runes. This knowledge, writing, was what he gifted to his mortal children. It was this nature of sacrifice that I wish to encapsulate into the hangman. One who goes to his fate, turning their world upside down, as it were, knowing that to achieve that which is most precious requires a yielding of the self. Odin understands this concept. In addition to his trial upon the tree for the sake of wisdom, intelligence, and foresight, he paid one eye for a drink from the enchanted will of Mimir.
And we see those runes. Right? We see those runes in the light seers. The reference to the runes and the light seers.
Yes.
Right.
There's a lot going on in that. It's beautiful.
It never spoke, though, in her, in the book about the Ankh and the red ribbon. And we notice in Shadowscapes that the red ribbon is in many, many, many of the cards. Mm. And she probably talks about the red ribbon in a previous card we've studied, because I vaguely remember reading that. But that's the only thing I noticed in the card that she didn't speak to in the book. Oh my goodness gracious. No, oh, wow. I don't see any bumblebees in there, Kurt.
Mm-mm. Oh crap. Did I cover them up? No. I must have been thinking about a different card.
I think you were thinking of the Empress.
Okay, there was another one that had a heart hanging on it. I don't know.
No, yeah, right over here on the right.
Oh, okay.
And it has bees. Oh, it's her Rosetta.
It's the Rosetta that has the bees.
It's okay. The Rosetta.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Y'all, this Tabula Mundi kills me every time.
Mm-hmm.
What are those? Okay, I'm going to let you go, Kurt. I apologize. Go for it.
I honestly, I don't know what most of this stuff is.
Well, I'm asking, what are those things on the papers, the symbols on the papers?
Those are Hebrew letters. So that's the letter Mem, and I don't know what, but one of those means water.
And there's that egg again, the egg of the lovers?
The Orphic egg, yeah, the egg of creation, yeah. Yeah.
And so that speaks to what we were talking about earlier, Rachel Pollack's 2 and 6 and 12 and uh-huh. The energy of the lovers in the high priestess realm is the sacrifice, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
And this dragon thing is coming out of the water.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like a person. It's like that's actually a human under there.
Yeah, in the interpretation, she talks about the dragon mask, but she doesn't really.
And the dragon itself is actually what's binding him to the tree.
Yeah.
And oh, how, what do you call it? Demure, or I'm trying to think of a word I can't think of that fast. Of her to cover the package, you
reserved.
Guys.
Reserved. Yes, very reserved in that sense. Yeah. Demure. I
modest,
like that.
Modest. That modest. Was
modest. Yeah, yeah.
He's ripped everywhere else, though.
Yeah, yeah.
So you kind of get that by extension, but ha! Anyway, never mind.
Oh, and in the Rosetta one, I know we're hopping all over the place, but do you see the three nails, the hands and the feet at the top, and it's an Ankh upside down.
And it's the reversed Ankh. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So speak to me, because Kurt, will you speak to us about the Ankh? And that goes back to Shadowscape too.
So the Ankh, the Ankh has to do with fertility and life energy and so on and so forth. And it is kind of interchangeable with the cross in that regard. Like, I don't know. I'm probably leaving something out or missing something there. Denise, do you recall anything about that?
I remember that the bottom reading that the bottom of the Ankh was supposed to be representative of the trunk of the tree.
Mm.
Oh, well, interesting. And the cross was made of the tree, and there's the three mm-hmm. nails in it.
Mm-hmm.
And what's interesting about this one is that his fingers create the roots that go into the ground, and he's upside down, So really when we're traveling through life right side up, really our roots are with the divine. I mean, if you will, from a Western perspective, up in heaven, in the heavens. But speak to me. So I'm seeing water in all of these. And you talked, Kirk, we talked about water in the light spheres. So what can, but I don't think we went into what is it, it's emotions.
Well, it's the subconscious, it's emotions, it's literally, in this context, it's the waters of baptism. It's also, and our first baptism is actually our birth, right? In this life is actually our birth, because we come out of the womb
in water.
And so, and one of the, and I it could have been Malene, I can't remember, but she talks about that the position that the hangman is in is the position in which most of us come out of the womb.
Yeah, as we're born, that is wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah, and an initiation, a baptism is an initiation. It's an initiation into the Christian rite, right? But an initiation implies a rebirth.
Stop.
And really, and also if you're talking about like an initiation into a mystery tradition or something like that, just by way of example, supposedly Crowley made all of his would-be initiates memorize the book 777, which I can't even imagine. Like if you've even opened that book, all the different attributions and all those correspondences in that book, but he would make them memorize it before he would even consider them for initiation. And I bring that up as an example, just to say that when somebody's initiated into a tradition or into a family by way of marriage or into a life by way of birth or baptism or whatever, on the other side of that initiation is new meaning, right? New meaning for different attributions or different words, or new meanings of words that used to mean something else or something.
Oh, like hold that. Yes, keep going. Yes. New meanings of words and things.
Words, things, actions, like secret handshakes, different ways of reading a text, maybe, that are like secret teachings. Like you get to learn like the secret way of reading things or whatever it may be. But that's what an initiation implies, is that you're essentially reborn, like a new creature or whatever, right? The whole you can't put new wine in old wineskins. So basically the hangman is the process, the beginning of the process of generating anew so that one's form, one's being can hold that initiatory space. Because if we go into the next card is death, right? So you go from the initiation into the symbolic or literal death, and then, you know, death, rebirth. And then temperance is on the other side of that. And temperance is simply balance, is balancing. So after your rebirth, you come out rebalanced. So you basically have justice again in a different form. And temperance is also called art, which
is called what?
Is also called art.
A-R-T, like what I'm thinking and what I do?
Yes. About balancing of energy. So in the next few weeks, when we look at those cards, this is what we're gonna see, the continuing theme of this initiation and rebirth. But yeah, the Rosetta, the Rosetta and the Tabula Mundi, actually, and the sacred tribes tarot, those are the most watery hangmans I think we've seen yet.
Okay, so we haven't talked about Pollux. Is that what you're talking about, the tribes?
Yeah, yeah.
So let's look at hers before we traverse on.
Well, hers is a woman, first of all. I mean, that's significant.
Right.
And we've got a boat, a fish, a sun, a moon, an angel, a city, village, and we've got, is that the goddess, the fertility goddess?
Yes. Huh?
Mm-hmm. What's her name? I forget. Like the art teacher forgets.
Venus of Willendorf.
Willendorf, yeah. So, and then there's, I don't know if we even need to count, but all the stars in the tree.
Right.
And then if we notice her hair isn't there like the other people's hair, it actually is in the water. And then I don't know what's tying her to the tree, but we got something actually holding her to the tree.
I mean, knowing Pollock, it could be a snake. I mean, it could be.
Knowing Pollock, I think we'd see the head, no?
Well, probably, yeah. I'm just going by what different.
So what's the fish, the boat, the angel, which actually the angel almost looks like as if it's carrying a songbook or a scripture book or something. And then the village, and then for so this could be a very fertile space if we let it.
Well, and one way to think about it is it literally is a world tree. You know, like it's got all the trees, got all this stuff going on.
A world tree, okay.
Yeah. And two, you know, it's showing that the hangman is related to all these different things that are related to water. Plus, it's this liminal space, this time outside of time, this meditative space, which is that space that is outside of time.
Okay, did you ever explain to me about the dragon in the middle?
No, I don't know what the dragon means.
And the dragon has not only normal horns, but a unicorn horn as well. And the eye, the third eye, if you will, is in the water.
Oh, yeah.
And what are those weird tentacles coming out of the water on top of everything?
See, I really don't know.
But you have the book to this.
I do, but it didn't. I mean, I read through it really quickly, and it didn't necessarily explain all of that.
Okay, later I want to see that book page, okay?
Okay.
Or I guess I could wait till I get the deck. You do realize how much of what you and I have spoken about on a personal level is in this card? Like the whole, and I made notes over here, the whole through this initiatory process, there's a new meaning to words, situations, actions than they used to mean before in a different realm, if you will. And then the whole, I forgot what I was going to tell you about. Oh, yeah, the dreams and subconscious. I'll tell you that later. Okay, the rain, the big storm just stopped a second time. It's come twice now. Oh, my God. What's Tiamat mean? And what does it say at the top of that? Oh, the hanged man? Does it say the hanged man?
Yeah, it says the hanged man.
What's the Tiamat? Man.
The hanged one. Tiamat is the... she is the Sumerian, I believe Sumerian, goddess of... She's a dragon. She's a multi-headed dragon. If anyone on here has played D&D, Tiamat's a major figure in D&D.
That was a long time ago. I don't remember.
You probably didn't see Tiamat because you probably didn't have a character strong enough to go up against her in the.
I don't think we saw her with the group I was playing with.
Right, she's got tons of heads, and she's a big dragon, or at least depicted that way in D&D. But in Sumerian mythology, she's a dragon figure, and the idea is that she exists in this. And if I remember reading, it's been a while since I read this card for Tiamat, but it's that idea of the subconscious. It's that idea of embracing that which is, you know, which is in your subconscious.
Well, and what deck is that, Kurt?
Dark Goddess.
Do you remember if I like Dark Goddess?
I don't think I
really do, but I love this card. And what one thing I love about it is those are her knees sticking up, correct?
I believe so.
And her hands. So do you notice how she's fractured, if you will? Do you notice how she's abstract, if you will? Which you can be in the subconscious world and still be whole.
Okay, you just made Picasso make sense to me in that statement. Yeah, you just made abstract art, you know, like abstract expressionism make sense to me in that statement. That's really good.
Which you can be in the what in the subconscious world. Is that what I said?
Yeah, that's what you said.
And still be whole.
Yeah. And I believe that was what the card said, if I remember correctly.
I think I'm cut out for Tarot, Kurt.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, I'll tell you later.
I liked it. And then the as above, we have the circle.
Oh, well, that's Stonehenge.
Yeah, it's Stonehenge. And it's that in the ritual space, it's that you're in a space of time that exists outside of time.
Okay, hold on. Ritual space that exists outside of time.
Yep. And you can see that the priest it's a priest. He's called the directions. He's called the different elemental guardians of the four directions.
And that's the as above, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, puppy is back inside and now asleep.
Oh.
Sorry, guys. Yeah,
his name, Oscar?
His name is Oscar, but I call him Oski.
So did you have to tuck him in literally?
I kennel trained him. And so he sleeps pretty much, he sleeps in his kennel.
Does he have a little blanket?
He has a blanket and I give him lots of treats. So he associates his kennel with good things. And he usually curls up. He usually likes to go in there and he'll go in there right away. And, but there are some days where he just doesn't want to be in the kennel. He's like, nope, I don't want to sleep on the kennel. And one day it was like 3 in the morning. And he's like, I have to go outside to go go potty. And I'm like, that doesn't make any sense because you went, oh, well, I'll send you out. And he didn't want to come back in. Like, he was like, I just want to sleep under the stars. We all know what that's like, right? We all want to sleep under the stars sometimes. So anyway, sorry about that. I was listening to what you guys were saying. So even if I wasn't here right in front of the camera, I was absorbing. you guys are really good at doing the art analysis. I love it.
So, Denise, I really think that this is like seriously one of my callings, because
I agree.
But when I'm doing a reading, here's the problem. When I'm doing a reading for someone, I feel under pressure and I feel like I don't have the time that we have here to do that analysis, because they're sitting there going, well, if she were a good card reader, she'd be rattling it all off like this. Hmm. And that's not them. That's me and my proverbial shit, if you will.
Yeah.
And so, because like what we're doing here, neither one of us have read the books on these cards. And I haven't even finished reading the Pollock book. I've just learned tonight, like past what I've read. And so it's just, I feel called. Okay. Like that was a confirmation to me when Kurt said, I just made abstract art make sense to him in that. But if you look at that Tiamat one, I don't know if you were hearing, but if you look at her body, she's fractured, she's abstract. And my point was, I pointed that out and I said that you can be fractured and abstract in this subconscious space, in this subconscious world, and still be whole.
Yeah.
Which is what the divine wants of us in this time.
Yeah. That's beautiful.
And also one way to look at the hangman experience is in that light is trying to discover wholeness in the midst of that which is fractured.
Hang on, trying to discover, right? Because if we're looking at resistance as that pre, because the hanged man, that sense of fracturedness, or I think the resistance comes from not wanting to recognize that it is a fractured space that you're in, or a fractured outlook, or you've had fractured experiences.
Well, like, just not, you might recognize it, you don't want to accept it.
Yeah, that's possible too, right? That it's going to be at least one of those two things, right? That you don't want to accept it. And that it does allows you, I mean, you really do have to stand still and sit still and to be able to recognize that. And also to recognize that there's a concept in Latinx cultures and spiritual practices where they talk about susto.
Where they talk about what?
It's called susto.
Angel, can you spell that? Because I'm not understanding.
Yeah, susto, S-U-S-T-O. And it's this concept, this idea that when one has essentially a kind of like tower-like moment, where all of a sudden you receive a kind of jarring bit of news, or you were almost in a car accident, or you were in a car accident, you've had some sort of a traumatic something occur in your life. There's this idea that what happens to your spirit when that occurs, PTSD is also referred to in terms of susto, folks who experience PTSD, is that essentially what's happened is a piece of your soul or your spirit has fractured off and floated away. And that part of the healing process, literally a part of a piece of your soul is like flown, it's like it's cracked off and it's flown away. And it's one of the reasons why you never feel fully whole again, because you're in this traumatic state, right? Your traumatized state, post-state, that kind of thing. And part of what the healer does is then brings and works through prayer and through the use of remedies and ritual to help the person heal, to pull that piece back into and reintegrate it into the spirit of the soul so one can feel whole again. So I think that what we have here is a beautiful way to understand where that concept, right? It's not as if, so I'm kind of thinking through this, but I think that fracturedness can really, it's like, you know, we do have fractures or traumas, right, of various different sizes throughout our lifetime. And if we have a whole bunch of small traumas, that once you get that big trauma or that big thing hits, or it doesn't even have to be all that big, but it can have that feeling of being, yes, exactly. And then that too can cause that piece of the spirit, if you will, to break off and float away, right? Because there were already fractures in place to begin with. But yeah, that's a really, you know, so the hanged man is that sense of healing. It offers an opportunity for that healing. I love it. So that abstractness, the fracturedness, the wholeness within the fractured state. I love it.
Okay, and then we have not gotten to the So Below card, which Kurt, again, it's my card. That's me right there.
What I like about it is that, you know, the light is represented by the actual sunlight coming through the window.
And we saw on another card from this deck, we saw those red dots before. Do you remember that?
Yes, yes.
Was it on the running by the river?
I think so.
The red dots? So those red dots are honestly, they show up in multiple of these cards. I've got them, and they show up in multiple. So I'm seeing the light coming through the window. There's white dots in this one, but there's red dots too.
Yeah. So are those like her spirit guides, or?
You know, do you want me to open the book and see if it talks about that?
The book doesn't talk about much, honestly. Like
what are we in? So Below?
Yeah.
Because around some of those red dots, you have like little mini auras around them, like, you know, starbursts more like.
Yeah. Right? I'm surprised. I haven't really been using the book when I pull these cards. This book doesn't really say anything.
No, it doesn't.
Like really nothing. It gives you the name of the card and a picture. And really, that's about it.
The as above says a lot more, but the so below doesn't as much.
Very interesting. Kurt, I have to thank you. I love these decks.
Yeah, I like them. I like them a lot myself. All right.
I have it, but I haven't played with them yet. So
you got it?
I have it. I have, yeah. I haven't played with them yet.
So here we have the wounded. This is supposed to be the Fisher King. Again, the idea that he's in this liminal state, and all in the Fisher King story, basically the knight has to the knight won't admit that the king is actually wounded. All the knight has to do is admit that the king is wounded, and the king and the land will be healed. But the knight won't do it because he's afraid to. He's afraid to essentially admit, you know, what's in front of his face.
What deck is this?
That's Arthurian. That's the Arthurian.
So the Fisher King, what does that mean? Like fisherman?
Yeah. There's a story. I think it's Gawain. I can't remember. I'm pretty sure it's Gawain. It's one of the knights.
Well, does he maybe want the king to die?
Well, no.
So that he can inherit the land or something?
Well, no. What it is that the king is wounded, but the knight refuses to acknowledge that the king is wounded. But that's the key to the riddle, is the simple acknowledgement of the wound.
Well, and Denise, that's what you were speaking about, not acknowledging that fracture, resisting. Yeah. So there's the resistance in that card. So if this were the deck I were using for a reading, and I think we should start pulling these remarks in, if for some reason spirit called me to use this deck and I'm reading for you, I would immediately know when I look at this card that you're in a state of resistance, that I need to guide you to potentially see that surrendering would be in your best interest.
Essentially not acknowledging the wound, or the pain.
Which is why you're in resistance, right? You just don't want to.
Okay, now, I'll wait till you move on and then I'll say my next thing.
So this card is...
What was that, the Arthurian? What was that
deck? Arthurian, yeah, Arthurian deck.
Like King Arthur?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is that what that means?
Yeah.
Okay, the middle card, so didn't Pollock speak, wasn't I reading in about the drowned man on page 152?
Yeah.
So the Golden Dawn. Okay, so this is where I got lost in the reading, you guys. When I read this paragraph, that's when I closed the book. It was too much for my brain to comprehend. The Golden Dawn introduces an alternative title, The Drowned Man. To match the description, the spirit of the mighty waters. I don't even know where that description came from, so I don't understand already in the first sentence.
Spirit of the Mighty Waters is the esoteric title for the Hangman. It's an esoteric title for the Hangman. So they're one and the same.
Thank you. Okay, so do you understand why I closed the book at that point? Because I was already lost right there.
Yeah, I wouldn't have known that, except I also looked at Tarot Deciphered, where they make a big deal about that.
Then she says the Hebrew letter, think of the Mundi, the Tabula Mundi deck.
Yeah, the Hebrew letter
Mem they give to the Hanged Man is one of the three mother letters that compare to the elements fire, water, and air. The Fool is Aleph for air, Judgment is Shin for fire, and Mem, which literally means water, is water. So the three cards that I hear her speaking of is Fool, Judgment, and Hanged Man. In water, all things that seemed fixed and rigid dissolve, including the ego and its assumptions about reality. To drown, now this is making sense, you guys. To drown can mean to surrender, to release the self. In The Wasteland, the modern epic poem based on the Grail legend, Eliot has his tarot reader, Madame Sosostris, say, here is your card, the drowned Phoenician sailor. I do not find the Hanged Man. Fear death by water. I don't understand everything she said, but that's it. That's that paragraph where I...
Yeah, so I have that poem queued up if y'all want to. It's read
Would
by...
Would you read it to us?
Well, I have it on a video. It's read by Sir Alec Guinness. But it's 26 minutes long, so we'll see how long y'all want to stay on the video.
Oh, okay. TSA. So is that where this deck is bringing this drowned man? But this deck doesn't look really Hebrew. It looks Egyptian, yes?
This is an Egyptian. Yeah, this is an Egyptian deck. And then I can't remember, isn't this Wildwood, right? The mirror?
The one on the right.
I'm pretty sure
that's Wildwood, is that the deck I have?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure that's the mirror. I mean, yeah, I'm pretty sure that's Wildwood.
Well, yeah, I mean, you're right. But I don't know why I'm confused. Position, the mirror. Okay, well, do you want to speak on it? Because I'm total like this.
I didn't read it.
Oh, is the hangman the person in the boat?
I don't think there is a hangman in it per se, but it is a very much a watery card.
Yeah. Very much.
You have the mirror. Both she's literally holding a mirror. Plus you have the moon. Mm-hmm.
Oh no, it is him in the boat. So okay, here I'll read it. Are you ready?
Okay.
In many traditions, the initiator into hidden knowledge is a female figure that reveals insights and wisdom to those on a spiritual sojourn. In the ancient Arthurian cycles, this is Morgan who takes Arthur on his journey into limbo and healing on the Isle of Avalon. So then that would be him in the boat.
Right.
Yes?
Yeah.
The Lady of the Lake is another such primal figure who also acts as a holder and guardian of the sword Excalibur and as arbiter?
Arbiter.
Arbiter of Arthur's actions. What does that mean? Arbiter.
Judge. Evaluator.
Both of these archetypes represent the unconscious journey of the soul into deeper awareness and wisdom. No act of will can make the soul take this journey. It can only happen after much searching and questing. It is also a precondition of this experience that some kind of wounding has taken place. It is through the pain and endurance of the wounding that wisdom comes, at which point the individual can cross the lake to the island, Denise, of healing and protection. It is a natural, we need to remember that, state of surrender, and it is natural that allows the inner self to travel across the emotional sea to the other world. The mysterious figure holds the mirror that aids our inner reflections and the orb of seeing that helps illuminate the shadows of our inner life. The heron stands both as a keeper of the mysteries and as a guardian of the other world. In some legends, three cranes or herons were seen at the gates of this magical realm and croaked warnings to the unprepared or uninitiated visitor. The cauldron represents, where's the cauldron?
I'm not seeing it. Are y'all seeing a cauldron?
Would it be the thing around the heron's neck?
You know, it could.
The cauldron represents the vessel.
Is that what that is around the neck of the heron?
That's the only thing it could be, right?
Yeah, but it looks like a medicine bag or something.
It looks like a Native American medicine bag.
Yeah.
So the boat wouldn't be the cauldron, would it?
No.
No.
Okay, so the cauldron represents, well, maybe because it says vessel. The vessel of hidden knowledge and inspiration. From it, the bright flame of insight and revelation illuminates the dark landscape.
Oh, so he's talking about stuff that's not on the card now, because we don't see a landscape.
This is the card in the traditional tarot known as the Hanged Man. We have chosen to amalgamate aspects of this into the Blasted Oak while the reflecting mirror offers the same dizzy change from one state of being to another. As the hanged man sees life from another angle, so those who look into the mirror see things reflected as they truly are. Patience and prudence are the key words here, although, Denise, thank you, trust plays a large part in the process of crossing to the island where insights into our own unconscious workings may be revealed. This process differs from the journey of the hooded man who makes a conscious decision to withdraw and contemplate the universe. In the mirror, a surrender of will is required. Insights may come from dreams and meditations, but now is not the time to force the pace or drive on with a plan or desire until you have heard what your soul has to say and your bruised and wounded spirit has been healed. Be patient and let this journey commence and awaken afresh and full of energy, ready to deal with the world and the challenges it raises. There's only one part that I didn't read to you guys. And it's just a description of the card, but if you want to, I have it if anybody is interested later.
That's wow. That's a really cool interpretation.
Yeah. Wow is all I have to say. Wow.
I'm still trying to see a cauldron in this.
The inner journey, psychism, I've never heard that word for psychicness, but that's what I was thinking with the orb. Psychism, the Lady of the Lake, Morgan as the healer and initiator of Arthur, Fisher King, Long Dark Night of the Soul, the Dark Woman of Knowledge, the Crane Bag of Secrets. Sir, how do you say this, y'all? Cerdwyn's Cauldron?
Caradwyn.
Caradwyn's Cauldron. And then what's this? Selkies,
yeah.
Mermaids, the three muses or fates, goddesses of sexual energy and healing.
So she's a Selkie, basically. That's
I don't know what a Selkie is.
They're water spirits.
Mm-hmm. She's not the Lady of the Lake. The Lady of the Lake
is also that. She's also
that. Oh, yeah. She's also, yeah.
Okay. She's all of this and more.
She's Morrigan and a Selkie and Lady of the Lake.
She's all of these.
A Selkie is a water spirit?
Yeah, I believe so, right?
What is Caradwyn?
Caradwyn is a goddess, Celtic goddess, goddess of the cauldron. So
Breed and Caradwyn the same to ask
that I don't know.
Okay, let's look that up.
But it could be that the all of the water together is the cauldron.
Maybe. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting point of view, Kurt.
The lake would be the holder of the vessel.
Yeah. Yeah.
The lake bed.
So you're saying that the whole lake could be the cauldron?
The whole lake is like the cauldron, yeah. That's the only thing I can think of because I'm not seeing a cauldron in that card.
Not pretty.
The Lindstrider.
I don't know that deck at all, but I thought that card was so cool.
Looked at that deck to buy it, you guys. But I haven't bought it yet.
Very minimalist. I love it.
And so after our discussion on the hangman so far, I'm looking at the owl as the hangman in a totally different light. The idea of the hangman revealing to us the way things really are, you know, and this is the
well, it's the wisdom part of it. What deck is that?
Chrysalis.
Of course.
Oh,
And so what do you want to say about the owl?
I'm just saying that it makes sense that, you know, that if the hangman is to reveal to us or have us contemplate the way things really are, then it makes sense that the owl would represent that, because the owl, it kind of is a portent or an omen, you know.
The owl is an omen?
Yeah, like if you hear an owl, it's kind of a reminder to, you know, look at that, just take things into account, you know.
Well, Kate, remember I've been hearing owls at certain very specific times?
Yes, that's what made me think of that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what's this, the spirit deck?
No, this is the one over here. This is
the one on the right.
Spirit song.
Anything else you want to say on the owl in the middle? Like anything about the knot work? Is that Celtic knot work on the stone?
Yeah, it is.
Mm-hmm. Is that kind of like mysteries?
I would think so. I'm not terribly familiar with the significance of Celtic knot work.
And what about the tattoo looking henna looking thing on his head?
I don't know what that is about either.
He's beautiful.
Yeah.
Looks like a crown.
Yeah, it does.
So, okay.
So here is the owl and the spirit. Of the spirit of the animals oracle.
Oh, cool.
The door pee.
So what it says is choose to follow the truth because you can.
It says what?
Choose to know the truth because you can. Open your inner vision. You can see through deception. Let the past go and make room for a better life. Rise up. Magic and wisdom are your birthright.
That's cool.
That's getting at those concepts, definitely. So cool.
And then here's where we begin with the praying mantis.
What I like about this one that I didn't notice when you showed it, Denise, is on that circle of fauna that he's in, if you will, there's all these flowers growing out of it up to the heavens, and they're growing on the bottom too, but the ones on the bottom are really tiny, and the ones that are going up to the divine are these big, bountiful, beautiful flowers.
Yes.
Very rooted in nature, in the fauna, just beautiful. And he has a halo around his head like our hanged man.
He does have a halo. I can't wait.
Are we at the end, Kurt?
I believe we are.
Kurt, this was one of your best presentations.
Yes.
Really was. You did an excellent job.
I mean, I think it was just, thank you, but I think it was just the cards themselves. I mean, they're just, it's.
You made a great presentation, Kurt.
Okay. I think it's so much fun. I love this part of our meeting every week. It's beautiful. I was going to show you.
Oh, that's cool.
This is, they call the Hangman Surrender, and this is the the Guardian Tarot.
And the you tilt it so that it's not glaring as much? No, tilt it downward. Right there. Guardian Tarot. Uh-huh. And is that like a bird bath that leaves from a tree or falling in? Oh, the tree is the person.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I see
the
that.
The leaves are the hair hanging down and they're that, falling yeah. off into the bird bath, if into you will.
The vessel, yeah.
Into
yeah.
the water.
Into the water. And wow. the concept behind this deck is really, really interesting. It was the artist, they're all watercolors, number one, and number two, the artist is from Maine, lives in Maine, and her son, she was walking with her son. They live out in a rural area, and out in the middle of a cleared field, you know, there was a single lone tree, and it was clearly it was a dead tree. It was not alive. And then there were all of these trees by the railroad track that were alive. And so that got her talking to her young son about, you know, what is it about trees and life, death, pollution, all this kind of stuff. So all this whole deck is built up around the spirit of trees. It's a really, really cool concept. And it's very beautifully abstract. So I just wanted to share that as something that was a little bit different. And then I also wanted to take an opportunity to share the Everyday Enchantment Tarot and look at the Hanged Man here.
Oh, well, that's funny. That's cool.
Yeah. That sense of, yeah, and I haven't read the description on it, but there's this, you see this little girl over here? This child is sort of screaming, and there's a spider that's coming down, this huge spider. And so I haven't read to see whether she's screaming because she's frightened to death of the spider or what is going on there. And then all of the cards,
at the top.
There's a dove.
There's a little
spirit and enlightenment. And then you've got this little it is like an imp, right? There's this kind of little energy. These pop up in not every card, but
well, they remind me of the troll. You remember the trolls from the I'm a little younger than you, but the trolls in the 80s, the little toys
with the fuzzy crazy hair,
the crazy hair. Yeah. Yeah. That's what it reminds me of.
I used to love the trolls.
The whimsical little troll. Yeah. You know, that's kind of and I love how happy that the hanging figure is. And that seems very pandemic to me, because like everybody in the background's all like worried and
they're all fretting. I know. Give me a break.
And then the hangman's just, you know.
it's really going to be okay, everyone. And if you relax, this could actually be fun.
Yeah.
Right? If you allow yourself.
Very pandemic. Yes.
Yeah.
Very nice observation.
Very nice. So this one, and then the other one that I think is, I think I want to show you this one. This deck right here.
Ooh,
I like that one.
Isn't this interesting? This is the Nicoletta Ciccoli or Ciccoli. I think it's Ciccoli tarot. And this is the pocket size, the pocket version. But the description with the white booklet that comes with it says suspend disbelief.
Mm.
I like that.
Suspending disbelief. I love this deck. This is a wonderful deck, in my view. And then here is the kawaii.
Isn't that like great? Hang ten.
Yeah, like hang ten.
Mm-hmm. Read
you gotta relax.
I love the little descriptions on the kawaii. Read the little description if you would.
Let me get it.
Because I love right they're short, but they're very poignant. Yeah.
All right, I shall read it. The hangman represents an important shift in perspective and consciousness. It may appear when the quarant is feeling vulnerable. It is a positive sign that you should step into the unknown and let it change you. The fool walks away from justice, thinking of the karmic balance of the universe. She sits by a tree and ponders. Soon she becomes overcome by thoughts, and in an effort to clear her mind, she climbs the tree. Before she can realize what she is doing, she is hanging upside down on a tree branch by her legs. In this temporary and reverse state, she asks herself, what lasts? What lasts? While trying to answer the question of what to grasp, she finds a small window between the spiritual and material, and the fool reaches enlightenment. This card can represent a feeling of finding peace and being able not to take the events of the world too seriously. If you get this card in a reading, suspend your sense of time to try out different perspectives.
Hmm.
And then I think of, you know, Hang Ten. I think of surfing, catching a wave. Because when you're in the wave, if you're going to ride the wave the entire way, you have to suspend, you have to surrender into the wave kind of
thing. Yes.
Yeah.
Do you mind taking a snapshot of that, what you just read, and putting it in the group or something?
Yeah, I can do it.
I think that was a really good.
I would have written the whole thing if I could keep up with you.
I agree. Okay.
The Hanged Man?
Yes, yeah. In that particular take of it was wonderful.
All of the descriptions for the kawaii are like that. They're very.
Kawaii, is it from Hawaii or something?
Kawaii. I'm not sure. I don't.
What's kawaii?
I don't know.
Don't know.
How do you spell it?
No. Like Hawaii, only with a K. Huh.
I don't know if that's a person's name or if that's a, if it's a, yeah, I don't know. But it's a really sweet deck. I know Heather got it for her daughter, her 9-year-old
daughter.
Yeah,
I remember that.
Yeah.
Because I bought the deck to do inner child work.
Oh, nice. Sweet. That's cool.
I also bought the Nicoletta deck to do child work, inner child work too. Very different kinds of. All right. So I'm
gonna see. Nicoletta deck.
Nicoletta. And then you want the reversed as well? I'll do the reversed. There you go. Then let me think, is there anything else that I have here? In the Tarot of the Divine, really quickly. This is Sleeping Beauty. This is the one that relies on all of the folk tales.
Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah, that
makes sense. Yeah.
So it is Sleeping Beauty is a symbol of stasis with the option of sleep or death. She chooses to wait for more favorable conditions. So suspension, restriction, sacrifice, readjustment, improvement. So there's that. And then this is, I think, like a very stylish, and if you can see that.
Oh, is this from The Dreaming Way?
It is from The Dreaming Way.
Okay, now that card I love from that deck.
Yeah, I think it's just magnificent. It's beautiful. And there are these hangers over off into the, and I'm like, what are those triangular? And I'm like, are those actual like clothes hangers? They look like clothes hangers, there's probably a much more symbolic, deeper symbolism going on there, but there are a series of hangers that are sort of intertwined. It's really weird. When you go in, they are hooked on the tree right here. I'm trying to see right here at the very top. And then another hanger is hooked into that hanger.
Yeah. Like a barrel of monkeys.
Yes. Yeah. And I'm not sure. I haven't looked at the... I can look at the book to see if there's anything that says more about that, if anything. Let's see. We should consider the reason why the hanged man is hanged. There are benefits to this position. First is halting. You cannot observe the world when you move at the same speed with the world. Second is upside down. You cannot find any new things when you view the world the same as other people do. The third is thinking. You should think if you want to figure out the meaning of what you have observed while you're halting. Therefore, this card indicates contemplation.
And what deck is that?
This is the Dreaming Way.
Okay.
Yeah, contemplation, response, difficult decision, seeing things in opposition.
That's the reversed.
That is actually the upright.
Okay, I put it in my thing to read the Dreaming Way.
Yeah, read that one. And then I think that's pretty much it in terms of the cards that I pulled. Just a really nice kind of simple.
Oh, that's cool. That's
called the Everyday Tarot?
This is the Everyday Tarot. Cool. Okay, this is the pocket size.
And is it purple and gold?
Purple, gold, and white.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So it's a beauty. I love this little deck so much. And the pocket size, when I purchased it, I think was going for I think I maybe purchased it for 12 and a few weeks later, the price dropped to below $10. It was $9.95.
I don't have the deck, but what convinced my friend that she wanted to pay, exorbitant amount of money for the Beatles tarot was the Hangman card in that deck, because the Hangman card in the Beatles tarot is Stu Sutcliffe. And if you know anything about the Beatles, that he was the fifth Beatle who actually killed himself.
Supposedly
it was before they became famous. His girlfriend created the Beatle haircut.
The bowl.
Yeah, his girlfriend created that. Yeah, and the thing was is that Stu always felt like he wasn't as talented as the other guys, and he kind of was holding them back, and so he died under very very mysterious circumstances.
He killed himself.
I don't know if it's entirely been proven, but that's the general consensus. And so my friend saw that, and she was like, wow, whoever made this deck really knows a lot about the Beatles. This is really
It's the Beatles on Kickstarter or what?
It's done now. Yeah, it's done.
And
now.
So when you say it's done, does that mean you can never buy this deck ever again?
Well, you can try to order it from the dude's website. But it's expensive. I was gonna get it, but I'm like, I just no. I got his.
What do you mean expensive? $60?
$80.
Oh.
Yeah,
You mean expensive with a capital E?
Yeah. And I got his previous deck, which is the Gnostic deck, which I haven't.
Ooh, you have the actual deck of that?
I do. Yeah, I haven't looked at it. I haven't played with it yet. No, I haven't.
I want to see that deck because I used to go to classes to study Gnosticism.
I love Gnosticism. That's my
jam.
Yeah, that's kind of, yeah. Like I totally get the Gnostic sort of approach to Christianity, the idea that, you know, how can this angry God of the Hebrew scriptures be the same God that Jesus is talking about, you know?
Exactly. Okay, I'm gonna pull each of you a non-tarot card for the day, for tomorrow. We can do it for tomorrow, whatever. Okay.
And oh, yeah, you're okay, yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Hey, this is an Austin, a gift from Austin for us. So, Angel, I'm going to do you first.
Okay.
Do you have a little one with you?
No, she's in the other room.
Oh, but do you have, like, oh, okay. I was going to pull one first.
Did she want a card?
Angel. I'm hoping one falls, but these are so big, I don't know if it's going to fall out. I'm going to take this card for you. So tomorrow or sometime, you need to take a
cat. There you go. I think you should take that advice.
I am.
Okay, so I'm going to put that back in the deck. And Kurt, I'll do you next. Kurt.
Yeah, I need to wait.
That's not in here. Oh, and the fan blew two out. But I have the fan right here, so they were blown.
Okay.
You're not even going to believe what one of these is. I can't even give it to you, but it's almost paradoxically funny.
Okay.
I'm not even going to read it. You're going to have to.
Okay, make yourself a bowl of pot. Oh my God, no. Yeah, that's what screwed up my colon. So we're not doing that.
And so the other one was go through old photos.
Okay.
Do you have any old photos to go through?
I can't find. I've been looking for my baby pictures for probably a year and a half in this apartment.
I feel like you got gypped, Kurt, because the fan is forcing things.
I find it hilarious.
So I'm going to turn the fan off while I do this again.
Do not make yourself a bowl of buttered popcorn.
No, messed him up.
We're not doing that. Yeah, we're not doing that.
Kurt Meyer. Kurt, I can't do this for you.
What does it say?
Everything is like you take a bubble bath.
I don't have a bathtub.
I'm telling
Unless
you.
Unless somebody wants to come over here and squirt bubble bath on me in the shower, and like, I mean, I'll go for that.
I'm just going to pull one. I feel like you got gypped. Look up a word you don't know. You probably don't know all the words.
I do not know all the words.
But you would have be hard pressed to find one.
I look up words all the time. That's how I keep learning.
That's what you do. So I pulled cards today for these kids I was with.
Oh,
and I pulled one, and I only took like that many because they were more kid friendly. And so one of them was make a list of things that you're grateful for. And the 7-year-old says, that's the one she pulled. And she goes, well, I already did that today. I want another card.
Oh, awesome. That's
okay,
great.
Okay, Denise, it's your turn. Denise. And this card. Oh, Denise, this is, I don't know how comfortable you are. You'll be more comfortable soon.
Oh, yay.
That's cool. Yay. So we need to put a plug in because CJ's doing a vendor thing this weekend on Saturday.
I haven't even filled out the paperwork.
Are you thinking about not doing it or what?
I'm thinking about it, but I want to do it. Picked up two pieces of my artwork from someone to bring with me.
Where is it at?
It's at my church.
Oh, it's for your church. That's right. That's Saturday.
Yeah, Saturday. But I told Pastor Arlene you were coming. So, but I mean, if you can't, for some reason,
I don't know if it's my tooth or what, but I'm having severe blood pressure and tooth and everything problems. And like where they won't even do oral surgery, like even if I had the money.
Wait, they won't even.
They wouldn't do it if they put me on a blood pressure. If they took my blood pressure, they wouldn't.
They would have to get your blood pressure.
Especially if it's a doctor that doesn't know me,
mm-hmm.
which at this point, that's what I'm reduced to because I owe everybody money.
I'm going to pull some cards too. Now you've inspired me, CJ. So I'm going to go get a deck.
Well, and these were just, you understand, these were just fun cards.
I love those though.
But
yeah.
Those are cool.
Okay. So you guys, what are your thoughts on me including these in tarot reading?
You totally should. Because
like at the very end as my gift to you.
Because nobody does that. You should do that.
Okay. That's cool. Then I like that.
Yeah.
Sadly today, the box got wet in my bag. I don't know. I think it's because I was carrying Richard's juice with me with ice packs.
See, that's
and they were melting and it got, and it stained my box and it's peeling. So, wah.
I don't need to have popcorn. I need to have juice.
That's cute.
Oh.
64 emotional support animal cards.
That is
so we're gonna pull an emotional support animal for you.
Her name is Nut-Nut. Oh. So you're doing angel
in addition to Nut-Nut.
Okay. Don't tell Nut-Nut that.
We'll go in the same order. Angel, we'll pull one for you first.
Angel, I am so happy you're with us. Can I just tell you that?
Thank you. It's a Wednesday, so I was able to.
So is Wednesday better for you?
How about we just switch to Wednesdays, guys?
We can do that.
Hang on.
You have your meditations on Wednesdays, right?
No problems with that. Normally, either I'm going to be... the thing is, they've started to ask us, those of us who've been through the spiritual leadership program, to start picking up some slack and doing more. So they've asked me to start hosting Wednesday and Sunday meditations more.
That's cute.
So you know what? Could we do like every other week, like Tuesday, Wednesday?
I don't mind doing that, but we need to like remind each other what days it's going to be on, because I will
that way we can have more people possibly show up like Angel to the group, but then also I would have half of my Wednesdays available to Celebration Circle.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
if you remember, Wednesday was also the same night that Arlene asked me to lead meditation for Bethany.
Well, she said I think she meant during the day. Like a morning.
Can you double check on that for me? Because I wouldn't see it as that way. I would see people are working during the day.
Well, no, not, I mean, half of Bethany's retired people or semi-retired people.
But why would you want to exclude the people who have to work?
That is a very good question.
That happens in a lot of congregations.
I heard it as.
Okay. Evening. I'll find out, but and right now there already is a Bible study Wednesday mornings.
So it would probably be Wednesday night. Angel, is there a different night that would work for you other than Wednesday?
Thursday, Friday.
Kurt, what do you think?
Friday, you can't do Kurt Friday, right?
No, Thursday would work.
Thursday would work for me, you guys.
Well, let's look at Thursday and see if Thursday works. Yeah, we can try it.
That is cool. I love that card.
So Angel, is that my card? Yours. Angel, this is your card. So
that is cool.
You are strong enough.
I love it.
So that's your message from your therapist.
Got attitude too.
And it's a unicorn, Angel.
I know.
Okay.
She's got attitude.
All right. So that's Angel's. Let's see. We'll do Kurt.
I get a unicorn.
You are not a. Oh my God! How did you pick that?
Can you shut? Can you talk? I can't see it. Can you talk, Denise?
Yeah, says, you are not a burden. We are lucky to have you.
Okay, Kurt, she picked that for you.
I know, that's why I'm saying, how did you pick that? Wow.
Wow.
I shuffled and I kept the deck.
That's perfect.
That's perfect.
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Thank therapists. Thank the therapists. All right, CJ, let's see what we've got for you, sweetheart. Geez, that one just popped out, just the way you like to read your pop-out cards.
Yep.
Girl, today is a brand new day, and you are a brand new person. Good luck.
She's gonna...
Yeah, but you need to let Denise talk so I can see it.
All right. So today is a brand new day. You are a brand new you. Good luck.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I love this deck.
Okay, now you have to do one for yourself.
Okay, I'll do one for me. Let's see.
Oh, well, I'm gonna pull a happiness one for me then while y'all do that.
Yes, you should do that. All right.
Oh, you know what? Kurt, you might be right about Daniel, because he grabbed this deck and started going through all my cards and he didn't even put them back right. And I remember having that conversation about you need to stop touching my stuff. So he might know where my crow oracle is. But yeah, that also disturbs me because he might also have my crow oracle. Oh, and we're recording, by the way. Yeah. And he's in our group.
Well, you got, which one did you get?
Okay. So it says, look at everything you have survived so far. You weren't defeated then. You won't be defeated now.
Oh my God. How perfect is that?
I love it. I love this little deck. Are you kidding me? I mean, this is like, so I've been focused a lot on inner child work. And so one of the things I love about Boho Tarot's channel, YouTube channel, is that her tarot practice is, well, everybody's, I think it's deliberate, but hers is really deliberate. So she has quite a collection. She's an artist. She has quite a collection of indie decks and mass produced decks and all that kind of stuff. But she's very, very intentional about thematizing her cards and using certain decks for working with certain aspects and things like that. She'll also categorize them according to seasons. It's a really cool channel. She does some really neat stuff with that. And I was watching her, and I've been doing inner child work lately. This has come up and I'm like, yeah, this is stuff I really kind of need to be very, very deliberate about. And I think I told you about the bunny, this little stuffed bunny rabbit and the yes. unicorn journal and all that. So I was watching her, watching one of her videos, and she was going through a deck, sort of like, here's my entire collection. It took an hour. It was intense. But finding cards that are speaking to my inner child are really important, or when I'm trying to do that work, which is why I have a couple of decks now, tarot decks that are very much inner child for me. But then I was watching TikTok, completely different. TikTok is one of those things that I'll watch, and sometimes if I'm not careful, I'll get too sucked into it and I'm like, oh my gosh, an hour has passed. But there was this one, I guess, channel that I follow, and the young woman is, you know, Nomad just won the Oscar for best film, right? And it's about nomadic culture, current, like basically like contemporary nomadic culture, which are basically people living in outfitted vans and cars. They're giving up mortgages. They're doing all of that kind of stuff. They're living in communities of other folks who have done the same thing. And so they're nomadic. They drive across the US into different places. They'll overwinter in places that are warmer, that kind of thing. And so, and a lot of folks, I mean, this whole kind of, this has been a culture apparently that's been very, you know, people like a subculture. And even more and more so, I think, since the tiny house movement, all of that kind of stuff, people are, tiny houses are turning into like converted vans, right? And we're not talking like RV kinds of things, although some people do use RVs.
No, we're talking like VW bug vans.
Basically, yeah. Yeah, we're talking like that, or we're talking like an SUV or even a car, right? So anyhow, there's this young woman who is part of that. She couldn't afford her rent. She was going through a divorce, couldn't afford her rent, moved into her car, and then just started going sort of nomadic and started filming her experiences. And so her TikTok just blew up. Well, somebody, she's also doing some really intense kind of, like, she is has an eating disorder. And so she has been working with a therapist for years, was to help her with her eating disorder. I mean, she was cutting and all this kind of stuff. And so she's been working that way. But anyway, somebody, one of her viewers sent her this deck. They just sent her a care package with this deck, and she showed this deck, and I was like, oh my God, that's the most amazing thing. And so I researched it to see, and was able to find the deck, and have it. It's the most beautiful, delightful, sweet, childlike
day. That is really great.
When you need that reminder, that special reminder, especially when you've got those voices in your head that are just having a field day. And I thought to myself, this is just a lovely thing to just have. And so incorporating these kinds of cards into your readings for others, I think is also.
Is Therapets on Amazon or no?
It is.
It is.
It is.
And it's probably not very expensive.
I think it was like $15 or $16.
Well, the Therapets, that's pretty great.
I just, you know, and here's the back. Can you guys see the back of the cards? All like, those wonderful. I mean, come on. Does that not scream
I could make a role-playing game out of Therapists. Like,
oh, yeah. Like, seriously. Look at all these, right? Look at all these beautiful.
Yeah.
I love that. The bird. And then I just love it.
See, I should get Therapets, and we could do Therapets on the Friday night gatherings for Bethany. Like, we could do.
Well, and I could pull one of these.
See, that would be perfect.
Me and you tag team between, like, maybe I pull someone one of these, and you pull someone one of those, and then we go back and forth. Yeah.
So, one concept that Arlene was, and we're still recording, but this says it's okay.
By the way, mine says change your alarm, which I really don't use one, but I might try it, to your favorite workout song.
But metaphorically, that can mean lots of things, right? So something that alarms you, like if you know, something that would trigger you, replace that which is triggering you into something that, and replace that trigger with something that gets you excited, gets you motivated.
Or like when I get triggered, go to a favorite song.
Yeah.
Like Eye of the Tiger.
Yeah, there you go.
Have your playlist on Spotify that.
Okay, I don't know how to use Spotify. I don't even know how to access my account because Richard made my account for me. And I don't even know what he used, what email. I have three emails. I don't know anything. And yeah, so there's that. So I only know how to use Pandora, and I don't know how to make a playlist, and I don't have a Spotify app. The only thing that uses Spotify for me is my Hey Google that Richard gave me. And I don't, that's all I, how, because it won't even, once he made Spotify, it won't even access my Pandora anymore.
Okay, I'm going to stop the recording just because.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. So, bye, good night. So,
now you
no,
all.
No, don't leave.
No, don't leave. Don't leave. Leave.
I was saying okay. Goodbye.
We're, to the we're saying goodnight to the people watching the video.
Don't leave, Angel. Right.
I'll be here then.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.